Hello, I'm Hannah, and this is Hannah's Books. Today I want to talk about three books exploring how different kinds of experiences of travel affected women's lives during the course of the 20th century. All three books came out fairly early in 2021, and I must say it was a somewhat strange time to read books about traveling. All three books had been planned and were in the publication process when the pandemic began. Due to the COVID-19 outbreak, the travel industry was all but grounded by the time the books were actually published. As many readers of travel books pointed out, instead of being able to explore the world in person, we were restricted to armchair travel in order to broaden our horizons. But these three books are interested quite specifically in the broadening of horizons that happened to women at different points during the 20th century. Maiden Voyages, Magnificent Ocean Liners and the Women Who Traveled and Worked Aboard Them, written by Siân, considers the experience of women from a variety of social classes who sailed across the Atlantic during the early decades of the century. The Barbizon, The Hotel That Set Women Free, written by Paulina, examines how a mid-century New York hotel, catering specifically to upper and middle-class women traveling alone, offered its guests a certain kind of independence. And Come Fly the World, the Jet Age story of the women of Pan Am, written by Julia Cooke, considers how the work experiences of international airline stewardesses during the era of the Vietnam War and the early women's movement opened up a whole new world for them. All three of these books suggest that women's travel opportunities were both a result of changing gender roles and a driver of those changes. In the early 20th century, transatlantic journeys aboard ocean liners offered women travelers of all social classes the ability to reinvent themselves. These ships offered hope, opportunity, and romance, explained Siân in Maiden Voyages. Women's travel experiences would change their lives forever, as the author says. On the ship's upper decks, wealthy women and celebrities spent their days eating breakfast in bed, taking swimming lessons, dining at the captain's table, and dancing to the ship's orchestra while wearing bejeweled ball gowns. Occupying less expensive rooms were female executives and buyers, a new class of travelers seeking to build international connections in the fashion industry or other fields. A few middle-class women traveled with hopes of becoming Broadway or Hollywood starlets. And the least expensive rooms on the lower levels of the ships were filled by refugees, people displaced by war, fleeing poverty, facing persecution, who sought to build new lives in America. Despite the fact that the wealthy, the middle class, and the poor all traveled together on the same boats, passengers on the upper decks had little contact with the passengers who were below. Evan's book is strongest, actually, when she discusses the women hired to work aboard the ocean liners. Before World War I, most of the women who were applying for jobs aboard ships were widows, financially responsible for their families. Their children were ensconced with their family members at home, and the ship stewardesses could draw a paycheck to support them, while women on land faced more limited employment opportunities. Stewardesses brought meals to wealthy passengers, helped them dress, tidy their rooms, nursed them through bouts of seasickness. Having female employees on board ensured the gendered proprieties could be observed. All was not smooth sailing in the years ahead. World War I interrupted vacation cruising and temporarily made jobs aboard commercial ocean liners all but unnecessary. Women stewardesses frequently retrained as nurses, whose shipboard skills were useful on floating military hospitals. Following the war, commercial ocean liners sailed once more, and women returned as both passengers and as employees. War widows immigrated to find financial opportunities, ensuring that female attendants stayed in demand. Over the next few decades, women's experiences aboard the ocean liners evolved as countries on both sides of the Atlantic experienced both financial depressions and women's suffrage, the growth of commercial culture, the outbreak of another war, and eventually airplanes replaced ocean liners as the primary means of transatlantic travel. Maiden Voyages is an engaging book and is accessible. The book talks about the historical context of shifts in gender roles during the first half of the 20th century. Evan's decision to investigate stories of enormous personal transformation is a fairly fruitful way to explore the impact of the broader social changes on particular women's lives. Her claim that transatlantic travel was life-altering, it does seem a bit overdrawn when applied to the wealthy women taking lavish vacations. But for non-elite women, travel was much more likely to be that, quote, step into the unknown that Evans celebrates. Well, by the middle of the century, the context of women's work experiences had changed even more. In The Barbizon, Paulina Bren explores how the eponymous same-sex hotel offered ambitious young women a comfortable place to stay in New York City. Built in the late 1920s in Midtown Manhattan, the Barbizon was a very well-appointed hotel. On the lower levels, there was a coffee shop, a library, lecture rooms, music studios, even a swimming pool. Upstairs, the atmosphere was not necessarily as grand, consisting mostly of simple bedrooms without private baths. No men, not even fathers or elevator attendants, were allowed above the ground floors at any time. Many middle-class and upper-class parents, fretting about their daughters' time in the metropolis, found this restriction really reassuring, and many of those daughters did as well. What distinguished the hotel was both the seeming safety it offered to women, to single women, as well as the sense of community it created, starting during Prohibition and continuing through changing ideas about gender and sexuality during the Great Depression, World War I, McCarthyism, and the beginnings of the women's movement. Although many of the women who lived at the Barbizon were not people destined to become famous, several of the hotel's inhabitants were. Some stayed at the Barbizon while they were participating in Mademoiselle's elite guest editor summer program for college-age students, as you may remember from Heather Clark's wonderful biography of Sylvia Plath. Other residents were students at the Katherine Gibbs Secretarial School, interns at the Parsons School for Design, or models for either the Powers Agency or for Eileen Ford. Bren discusses Plath, but also Jo Didion, Mona Simpson, Meg Wolitzer, actresses from Joan Crawford and Grace Kelly to Ally McGraw and Felicia Rashad, and many others. As the author writes, quote, "Before they were household names, they were among the young women arriving at the Barbizon with a suitcase, reference letters, and hope." Although all these women came to New York with expectations and desires larger than those of previous generations of women, the world they faced was filled with contradictions and limitations still. The young women who lived at the Barbizon tried to navigate the complex interactions of femininity and women's liberation. Most believed that their ambitions were limited to just a few years between college and marriage. Bren explains that, quote, "marriage was still the goal, but the Barbizon was its most coveted antechamber." The women also had to grapple with changing social attitudes towards womanhood. They lived in, quote, "a world that pretended to be virtuous, even puritanical, but behind closed doors was far more complex. Appearing to be demure and chaste while also addressing the increasing expectation for single women to be at least somewhat sexually active left many residents feeling ambivalent and conflicted. The opportunities to work out these complications of mid-century femininity, along with other talented young women, often led to lifetime bonds between residents who might have only lived together at the Barbizon for a few weeks one summer. The history of the Barbizon highlights how important it was for mid-century young women of ambition to finally have a room of their own. That independence was just as important for these talented young women as it was for Virginia Woolf and other women writers of an earlier generation. Okay, last one. Julia Cooke's Come Fly the World takes the story of women's travel and work into the latter part of the 20th century. When airplanes replaced ocean liners as the most common way to cross the sea, young women were hired as stewardesses to assist passengers during flights. Even though the vast majority of passengers on early international flights were men, women were chosen for these jobs for two reasons. First, American industry in general believed that caretaking was a traditionally feminine role, and that passengers were more likely to be comfortable flying when being served by women. Secondly, the young women's implicit sexuality was manipulated to appeal to male travelers. Pan Am, the international airline which Cooke focuses on, required its stewardesses to have college degrees, speak at least two languages, and undergo a training program where they learned everything from the mechanics of flight to how to take command of the cabin during an emergency. Although some airlines required stewardesses to dress as glamorous sex kittens, for example, by wearing fishnet stockings with mini dresses, or changing outfits mid-flight to animal print bodysuits, or serving dinner in pajamas, Pan Am provided its stewardesses with conservative, pale blue, knee-length skirts, tucked-in blouses, boxy jackets, and pillbox hats. Despite the nod to respectability, in its early years, Pan Am required stewardesses to be both unmarried and younger than age 26. The employees were trained to apply makeup and had to be within a particular height and weight range. If during regular checks a stewardess was above the required size, she could be grounded until she lost the extra pounds. Despite these restrictions, Pan Am really did offer its female employees broad opportunities. As Cooke writes, quote, "What was revolutionary was the lack of should in this job and the plenitude of could." Becoming a stewardess on an international airline allowed a woman to travel by herself, not only in European tourist destinations such as London and Paris, but also in cities throughout Asia and Africa, places rarely visited by Americans in the late 1950s through the 1970s, especially single women. Stewardesses also had opportunities to explore global politics firsthand. For example, Pan Am flights transported GIs to Saigon at the start of the U.S. involvement in the Vietnam War, from battlefields to locations where the soldiers could have a few days of R&R, and then eventually back to the U.S., giving the stewardesses the chance to see some of the complex effects of the war on soldiers. In perhaps the most moving part of the book, Cooke discusses the involvement of stewardesses in emergency efforts to evacuate Americans, as well as wives and children GIs had acquired in Vietnam. They also participated in Operation Baby Lift, which transported supposed war orphans from South Vietnam to the States by filling planes with infants strapped into cardboard bassinets. Stewardesses fed and cared for hundreds of sick children. One former stewardess told Cooke, quote, "Men waged war with no consideration for the disastrous consequences, and women worked together to clean up the mess." Travel exposed Pan Am stewardesses to events and cultures that broadened their perspectives on the world. Quote, "As individuals, stewardesses shared an instinct to roam that propelled their personal and professional growth," writes Cooke. She points out that the self-reliance of the stewardesses of Pan Am and other commercial airlines as well made room over decades for the women of later generations to, quote, "move with more ease through more of the world than women ever had before." Authors Evan, Bren, and Cooke all argue that the lives of the women they write about were radically changed by travel experiences, as well as by new work experiences that travel allowed. Maiden shows, though, female workers aboard ocean liners earned enough to support their families. Passengers in steerage fled poverty and persecution for new opportunities, and a few women built independent lives with careers in show business or fashion. In the Barbizon, Bren shows the mere existence of a women's hotel made some parents feel comfortable enough that they allowed their young daughters to travel to New York for eye-opening experiences, including career-opening internships. And as Cooke demonstrates in Come Fly the World, signing on to work with Pan Am offered young women a chance to see the world, an opportunity to engage in international political issues, and the ability to depend on themselves financially. The latter two books, which I strongly recommend, are especially successful at showing how changing definitions of femininity, as well as the development of feminism, affected the lives of the women who stayed at the Barbizon or who worked for Pan Am. No matter how they got there, women in the 20th century were going places. Thanks for joining me here today on Hannah's Books. See you soon.